Welcome, everyone. My name is Sarah Egger Weiler. I am a member of the District 4 Neighborhood Action Council, and I'm also an organizer for the General Greater Seattle Neighborhood Action Coalition. Thank you all for coming. It's so great to see so many wonderful faces here. Before we get started, I'm just going to go through an agenda for the night. First of all, I just want to thank everyone who helped to put this event together. And we have three incredible organizations. Both the Greater Seattle Neighborhood Action Coalition, Transit Riders Union, and 350 Seattle all came together to put this together. And it's basically all volunteers, people taking their time out of their busy schedules to do something that they're passionate about. So that's pretty incredible. And as well, because it is a volunteer event, this was not put on by the City Council or any particular person. This is all just passionate volunteers that are excited about this. And as well, we will be hosting six other town halls throughout the next couple of months. So this is the first of seven town halls to make sure that we can address all of our city council members all throughout the city and make sure that they're all have a chance to talk to us about this income tax initiative. So stay tuned for details on the other events in other city council districts. We don't have events set up for them yet, but we will soon. So before I go into the agenda, I want to talk a little bit about the Neighborhood Action Coalition and what we're all about. The NACs formed just after the election as a method of addressing the very real fact that a lot of vulnerable communities in Seattle may not be getting the respect or the rights or the privileges that more privileged communities in Seattle may get. So the NACs formed as a way of really bringing a lot of people power together, totally grassroots movements all over the city to make sure that as a city we are well-equipped to protect our most vulnerable communities and our most targeted communities. And each Neighborhood Action Council and each city council district is entirely autonomous. Basically, the thread that connects us all is our desire to be entirely grassroots, just people power coming together to make sure that as a city that we are protecting everyone in the city. And that's why I'm so passionate about the NACs, and secondarily why I'm so passionate about the Seattle Income Tax Initiative. Because for me, the whole point of this income tax initiative is to make sure that in the city of Seattle, that if we have a budget cut to any service of any kind, that as a city, we can still protect our most vulnerable communities, even if we don't have as much federal funding heading into our city budget. So a little bit about the agenda for tonight. First we're going to start with Katie Wilson. She is a member of the Transit Riders Union, and she's going to give a slideshow about the income tax initiative and go through kind of more details about the initiative itself. And then we are going to have Michael Tamayo from the Seattle Education Association. He's back, he's waving in the back. He can come on up if you would like. And then we're gonna have Devin Glaser from Upgrade Seattle give a short talk. And then we're gonna have Kevin Fenwick from 350 Seattle. And then the bulk of the evening is gonna be a time for Rob Johnson, our great District 4 City Council member, to talk and then have the opportunity for all of y'all to ask him questions. And I'll be moderating that to make sure that we do our best to stay on topic, because I know that we all have lots and lots of questions to ask our city council member, but we want to make sure we have as much focus as possible so we're not going too much over our time. And then after we're done kind of sitting formally, we'll have an opportunity to break up, and we have a couple of really cool kind of action-based stations outside for everyone to get plugged into. Awesome. So I'm going to hand the mic to Katie to talk about the tax initiative.
Okay. Oh, you might need to move. Okay, I'm going to get this projector started. Also, I want to say when we get to the questions, they don't have to all be directed at Rob. We're not primarily trying to put him in the hot seat here. So questions about the campaign are welcome. Let's see. Okay, so my name is Katie Wilson, and I spend most of my time organizing with the Transit Riders Union here in Seattle. And I'm just going to talk a little bit about this campaign. So I don't know about you, but I'm pretty sick of seeing Trump's face. So I thought that I would feature a couple of other people here. So we have some couple of friendly billionaires. Do people recognize those faces up there? Okay. It sounds like it. Okay, so those are the Koch brothers, and they're, you know, really a convenient symbol of the oil, industrial, financial, corporate elite. And over the past few decades, they and their class have sort of gone from, their ideology has gone from being sort of a fringe thing to a really driving force in American politics. Now, they didn't actually back Trump in the election. They sort of felt he would be an unreliable vehicle for their agenda. But since he got elected, since the election, they've been busy making lemonade out of lemons, and they've been doing a pretty good job of it. So their staffers are populating his administration, and the Trump budget that was proposed last week really comes out of the Heritage Foundation, which is part of their network. So while Trump is out there talking about travel bans and walls, while he's exacerbating the culture wars and doing a thousand things to divide us, people like those guys are advancing policies that really clearly and unequivocally are against the interests of the vast majority of the population. And that really sucks, but on the other hand, on the other hand, it means that we're dealing with a ruling elite that really doesn't have any credibility. So as soon as you know what these guys are about and the policies they're trying to push, no one likes it. Okay, let alone sort of the future of the human race on this planet, the short-term effect of the policies they're pushing are really against the interests of all of us. And so that means that they can only advance their agenda through deception and through distraction. And it also means that the more they succeed, the harder it is for them to distract us. Now, what that means, I think that really gives us a lot of reason for hope, because it means that they're vulnerable. And what they're vulnerable to is an effective movement. And that's really what I think Trump's election has given us the opportunity to build. That means we need to hit the streets, as we've all been doing, so that we can feel our collective power in numbers. But we really have to do more than that. We have to fight a policy war. We have to fight bad policies with good policies. And in order to win that policy war, we have to organize. And that's why I really think it's so important that we're all here today, because we're here to talk about a policy, and we are here because there are organizations and people in the room that are organizing to push this policy forward. And this is a policy, this is really a game-changing policy for Seattle and for all of Washington State. So with that, let's talk about where we're at. Here we have Trump's quote-unquote skinny budget. Now, if you are a weapons manufacturer or a big corporation that doesn't want to be hindered by environmental regulations, or if you want to privatize the education system, there's a lot to love about this budget. If you're anyone else, it really sucks. So basically, Trump is proposing to massively increase Department of Defense spending and to fund that by cutting basically everything else. Things that we really need, like housing, and also things like arts and culture. So basically, he's talking, they want to take away our bread and they want to take away our roses too, essentially. So what does this mean for Seattle? So over the past week, different city departments have been publishing memos about the effects of the Trump's budget on them if it goes through. We could lose over $4 million for affordable housing, over $1 million for weatherization programs for low-income homeowners, $5 million for emergency shelter, homeless services, and assistance to low-income homeowners. And public transit is really the big loser here. So there's a lot of transit projects that rely heavily on federal grants. The Madison Bus Rapid Transit that a lot of us have been looking forward to for a long time could be in danger. The First Ave streetcar, and a lot of projects associated with Sound Transit. Okay, so what are we going to do about it? First of all, we're going to fight back. We're going to do everything we can to make sure that Trump's budget doesn't become a reality. But at the same time, I don't know about you, but I can feel sort of helpless about what I can accomplish at the federal level. So we also need to protect people, and that means acting here in Seattle and in Washington State, and doing what we can to make sure that everyone has a dignified standard of living, no matter what happens at the federal level. But in that regard, we have a problem. And that problem is that we're already not doing a great job of protecting people. So we have a housing crisis, we have a homelessness crisis. We're already not able to ensure everyone a dignified standard of living. And it's not just Seattle. So as I'm sure everyone knows, in Washington State, we have an education funding crisis. The state Supreme Court has held the legislature in contempt for failing in our paramount duty, according to the Washington State Constitution, which is to amply fund the education, schools for the education of all children. So this sort of begs the question, how are we going to cope with these new threats if we're already failing to fund things? And it begs the question, why is it so hard for us to raise money for the things that we need here in Washington State? And the answer to that is pretty simple. We basically have the number one most inequitable tax system in the whole country here in Washington State. The most regressive tax system. And what that means is that the poorest people are paying a very high percentage of their income in state and local taxes compared to the richest people. And this chart, which you might not be able to read from where you're at, but Washington's number one, and if you're in the poorest 20%, you're paying 16.8% of your income in state and local taxes on average statewide. And if you're in the top 1%, you're paying 2.4% of your income in state and local taxes. And so the effect of this on our state's revenue is pretty clear. Basically, even though we have very high taxes for poor people in Washington State, we can't raise a lot of revenue because we're not taxing the people who have the money. We're taxing people who don't have very much money. So when we inquire a little further into why this is, it becomes pretty clear that the problem is that Washington State is one of only a few states in the country that have no kind of income tax. And if you look at income taxes, all the other states that have income taxes, state and local income taxes tend to be progressive. And because we don't have an income tax, we rely very heavily on sales taxes and property taxes. Sales taxes in particular are extremely regressive. Basically because poor people tend to spend way more of their income buying taxable goods. And property taxes are mildly regressive. And we all know in Seattle how dependent we've become on property tax levies. So this means that we, here in Seattle and Washington State, we basically created a tax haven for the rich. So this graph shows how, over the past few decades, how personal income has grown. So the population's been growing, wealth in our region has been growing enormously. But the lower bar there is taxable retail sales. So basically, our revenue, which comes primarily from sales tax, is not at all keeping pace with the wealth of our region. And I wanted to include this. This was in the Seattle Times just a week or two ago. And it's always nice when they help us with our campaign. But this is showing how Seattle in particular, comparing Seattle to 51 US cities, we are we're number four for the highest taxes at a income level of $25,000 a year. And we're also number four for the lowest taxes at an income of $150,000 a year. So basically, as far as taxes go, Seattle's a great place to be rich and a really sucky place to be poor. Now that doesn't sound very progressive, And here in Seattle, we really like to be progressive. So we better do something about that. Well, what are we going to do? The obvious thing is, well, let's tax some of that wealth. Now, whenever you start talking about taxing rich people, someone starts saying, oh, why do you hate rich people so much? So I think it's important to recognize that over the past decades, the wealthiest people, their federal taxes have been going down. So wealthy people, wealthy households used to pay a lot more in federal taxes than they do now. So that's important to recognize, and also that it's going to get worse if Congress succeeds in repealing the Affordable Care Act, because that basically will amount to a tax cut for wealthy households. 24 million people could lose health insurance over the next 10 years. Premiums could go up. Presumably people would die, basically so that millionaires can get a tax break. So what we're proposing is a Seattle income tax. And we are proposing that this would affect only households with income in excess of $250,000 a year. And I should emphasize that the income threshold is still under discussion among organizations in the coalition, and also the council members. We're hoping to pass this through council. And so it could be higher, but it's not going to be lower. So we're talking about households that make $250,000 a year or more. And the tax, and this is important to recognize because people get hung up on this, the tax would only apply to income in excess of that threshold. So if you make $251,000 a year, you would only be taxed on that $1,000 that's over that threshold. And the tax rate that we're looking at is 1.5%. So a 1.5% tax on adjusted gross income over $250,000 would raise over $130 million per year in the city of Seattle. That's serious money. So for comparison, the housing levy that we all passed last year is $40 million a year. And the homelessness levy that Murray is proposing for this year is, what, 50, 55, something like that. So anyway, that's a lot of money. It would affect a little bit over 21,000 households. That's about 5% of taxpayers. And again, only income above the threshold is taxed, so your first $250,000 is tax-free. Okay, so then this sort of raises the question, why hasn't this been done before? It sounds like such a good idea, we're such a progressive city, why aren't we already doing this? So this is very important to understand. With this measure, we are entering into two disputed areas of Washington state law. One of those is the question of whether an income tax is constitutional, a progressive income tax is constitutional in Washington state. And the other is the question of what the scope of municipal authority is. Does Seattle have the authority to pass a tax like this? And for a very long time, for decades and decades, the assumption has been that, no, you can't do an income tax in Washington, and that city's taxing authority is very narrow. So we, the campaign has been working with lawyers who've been doing research, and we believe that that's not the case, that actually an income tax is fine in Washington state, and that cities actually have a lot more authority than has been commonly assumed. So those are sort of the walls that have been boxing us in, and we're the bomb. We don't anticipate that any actual bombs will be used in this campaign, but we're the metaphorical bomb that's going to burst open those walls. And so we do expect that when this measure is passed, it will be challenged in court. And so there will be a legal process which could take as little as one, but up to several years, that will end up at the Washington State Supreme Court. And so our hope is that, and this will give them a chance to basically rule anew on these disputed questions. And so we have a very progressive state Supreme Court right now, and also very cognizant of our state's need for revenue. So we are hopeful that they will decide in our favor. And if they do, then that creates a very robust funding source for cities and builds the momentum to do a successful statewide effort to change our tax structure. So we are hoping that Seattle can take the lead, and we are looking to our council members to be bold and to move forward with this year so that we can get that legal process started and start getting that revenue. And finally, I just want to say that we have a big, broad coalition working on this. This is a letter that we submitted to the mayor and city council on March 1st when we had our sort of kickoff forum at City Hall. And we now have, I think, 40 organizations that have signed on. That's where we're at. So I will leave it there. And thank you all for being part of this campaign.
Thank you, Katie. And I'm proud to say that the Seattle Education Association's logo was on that. Introduce myself again. My name is Michael Tamayo. I'm a fourth grade teacher here in Seattle Public Schools, and I'm currently serving as vice president of the Seattle Education Association. And I see some of our members in the audience. David Sandler, how are you, sir? Good evening. Katie kind of gave the big picture of what the campaign's all about. I wanted to speak from two different hats. One being my educator, a public educator hat. I've been an educator in Seattle for the past 10 years, and also as a progressive citizen of Seattle. My wife and I live here in Seattle, and we have two young daughters, 6 years old and 2 years old, and I'm missing their bedtime, but that's okay. It's awful war, so I'm happy to be here. What I wanted to talk about a little bit is why this is important, and why specifically does Seattle Education Association and our over 5,200 members have an interest and stake in this campaign. We face serious challenges not only in the public education realm, but in the state. The state's in fiscal crisis. The funding for public education is in crisis. And it's kind of like how Katie was saying, we rely on levies to backfill what the state can't do. And so the levies are kind of like Band-Aids. And you know, our Band-Aids, you know, get ripped off every time they expire, and then we try to put it back on when the levy passes, and it gets ripped off again, and when you pass the levy, it gets put back on, gets ripped off. What happens when you take a Band-Aid off and on and off and on and off again? You don't have any skin left. You don't have any skin left on where that wound is. And so that's where we're at right now. That's where we're at with public education funding as a state. That's going to be a problem. And right now, we just got back from Olympia a couple weeks ago, and I'm not encouraged by what's coming out of Olympia right now as far as a permanent fix to our fiscal crisis. So that's my educator hat. But more importantly, I wanted to go into what's happening in Seattle with education. There's a little over 3,000 homeless students in Seattle Public Schools. And those are just the students that are reported being homeless. That doesn't count the folks who aren't reporting for homeless for many different reasons, whether it be their immigration status or otherwise. Seattle has the fifth largest opportunity gap in the country. Our students of color are achieving at a far lower level than their white and Asian peers. The reason why I bring that up is because you could parse that out anywhere it is: economic justice, housing, being able to find good-paying, livable-wage jobs. Those all affect the families that are most affected by that opportunity gap. That's why Seattle Education Association educators are on board with this campaign. It's because Seattle has an opportunity to be able to be the leaders in raising revenue to address the challenges that face not only just us as a city, but face the most vulnerable, which are our children, because they don't have a voice, they don't vote. We do. We are able to elect leaders on the city council. We are able to elect leaders in Olympia to do that. So I'm speaking as an educator to advocate for those students. The opportunity is now. Katie gave kind of a political landscape. You know, windows like this don't happen that often. The political landscape as such, where Seattle, progressive cities like Seattle, we need to take the lead on this issue. The political landscape in Olympia, it's gridlock. I'm not going to expect anybody in Olympia to be able to take the lead on progressive revenue sources. We're looking to our leaders in Seattle, and I think we have an opportunity with the city council to be leaders on finally offering permanent fixes for the lack of revenue in our system, not just for our students, but for our communities, for adults in need. And Seattle has that opportunity. That's why we're here. That's why the Seattle Education Association and our over 5,000 members will be fighting this campaign. That's why I hope each and every one of you, whether you have students in the public school system or not, will join us in helping lead the way. And I'd like to thank Councilmember Rob Johnson for, you know, hosting this event. And hopefully we could all come together to keep this campaign rolling. Thank you so much for listening.
All right, thank you guys all for coming here. Can you hear me okay? Am I doing reasonable well? Louder, all right. I'll try to talk louder, I'll try to talk slower, and I'm bad at both those things. So my name is Devin, I'm from Upgrade Seattle. This whole campaign is incredibly near and dear to me. I actually just finished my public policy degree, and when people asked me why I was going to school, I said it was to raise taxes. And they would look at me like I was crazy. And I would say, because we need to fund things that really matter. And if you look at Washington State, and if you look at Seattle and King County, we have not done that. We have not done that for a very long time. And we feel it. We feel it here. For the last 3 years, we've been pushing the city to build a publicly owned and publicly operated internet utility. But tonight, I'm excited to talk about revenue first. So I imagine many of us here have had those moments in our lives where, because we were broke, we had to spend more money than if we had access to money up front. It happens all the time if you're low income. Also happens if you're a starving college student. But you know, you can't buy toilet paper in bulk. You buy it one at a time. You can't buy laundry detergent in the big bucket, so you spend more per ounce. When you can't come up with the money up front, you're unable to make investments in your personal life that end up saving you money in the long haul. And in Seattle, when it comes to public investments, we're very broke also. Everyone on this panel can tell you what amazing things we could invest in if we had access to progressive sources of revenue. And right now, we don't have them. And I just want to add my voice to this great chorus. I don't know, I mixed metaphors. So I'll tell you how I ended up here with the journey that brought me. In 2007, the city did a study about internet, and they found that we could basically save $2 billion over a 20-year period if we were to build our own public utility, right? That's a billion with the B, and that's savings for every single one of us who has internet at home. Imagine what all of us could do with 30 bucks more a month, 40 bucks more a month, keeping it in our pocket. Hopefully it doesn't go to rent, it goes to something fun, but even if it goes to rent, it keeps you in your place. Basically, the reason we haven't looked to take advantage of this, the reason that we're still spending more money than we need to, the reason our money is being sent out of state to companies that no one really likes and no one wants to deal with, is that we've been too poor to invest in a public utility. There's currently about 15% of the city who can't afford their internet bills at all, and then the rest of us are paying way too much. I think that with a good, stable source of revenue, we could actually be investing in things that would save us money over the long haul, whether that's housing, whether that's our students, whether that's public utilities like Seattle City Light or Seattle Solid Waste. And I think now is the time that we could really do this. If you look around, you can see that there's so much wealth in the city. There's just epic growth. There is lots of people moving here with high incomes. You know, I grew up here my whole life. I'm really happy to invest in the community and help pay for things that we care about. And I'd like to see the same thing from the people who are doing slightly better than me and are also very much welcome in the city. But they can help us build the great city that we believe in, that we really need. So that's why I'm really excited to join the Trendproof Seattle campaign. That's why we're really excited as Upgrade Seattle to put our energy behind everybody here and everything we're going to do. I'm very excited to have Councilmember Johnston here tonight. And I hope that everyone gets involved after this, because I think that we can do a whole lot together.
Hey, everyone. Do I have a technician that, all right. So before I introduce myself, I want to invite our friend Ty, actually, to the microphone for a minute to from the indigenous community to put a little context to the space that we're holding right now. You hear that, Ty?
I'm going to start something that we would do within our own communities. This was originally the place of Chief Siashk, which is true name and not Seattle or not self. And this is a song from the Salish Sea. It's part of the creation story. And the song is the way that we start things off. And if you learn to sing a song, as you sing a song, your breath begins to coordinate with the other people. Your breath goes into synchronization. You become of one heart, you become of one breath. And this is a very special song from the creation story. And it goes, ho you we yo ho, ho you we yo ho, ho you we yo ho, ho ho yo, ho ho he yo, ho ho he yo, ho you we yo ho, ho ho yo. Chako ni wa du hui ba sh ma si, chako ni wa du hui ba sh ma si. Kadaway tum tum hoy hoy alta. And those words in English mean that our hearts will be different. It's singing that we're going to try to be better people. And that's why you're coming together tonight with all the rest of the people here, to be of one heart and of one breath, and to start making this place what it should be. Thank you.
Thank you, Ty. So my name is Kevin Fenwick. I'm a volunteer organizer with 350 Seattle. I'm one of the campaign coordinators on the Trump Proof Seattle campaign. I have also been a resident of District 4 for 3 years now. We did want to invite Ty up, and I just want everyone to keep in mind, as any space that 350 Seattle will hold, to recognize that we are on Duwamish land. When we talk about making Seattle a more progressive space, we really cannot start to truly liberate ourselves from denial until we recognize that we're perpetuating a narrative of oppression and exploitation. So first off, on that note, I actually do want to thank Councilmember Johnson, as well as the other council members, for making the right choice and deciding to, voting to no longer be renewing our contract with Wells Fargo. And that means that we are moving forward to a system of responsible banking that is not invested in the exploitation of our land and of the land and the water of the indigenous people, and not investing in the violation of their human rights and the violation of treaties. I want to say that I believe that Councilmember Johnson and the rest did that, made that choice, not only because they thought it was the right choice for the city of Seattle, but because they understood that this was part of a greater story, that their office, that their power had the chance to operate in telling a different story, where we don't invest in the select wealthy few whose lust for profits are waging a war on the rest of the community of life, but instead working to ensure that we respect the human rights and the urgent human needs of our entire human family. And as a climate activist and a constituent, I want to invite Councilmember Johnson to realize that we're asking him to work with us on this and fight for a progressive income tax in Seattle for that same reason. Yes, we can do right by our city. We can make Seattle a more affordable, more equitable, and a more just place for all residents. But this is part of a greater story, and I want to invite the council member to work with us to understand the weight of his office, the weight of that power and the responsibility, and understand that we're currently creating the story for ourselves and our future generations, where we can not only do this for Seattle, but lead the way as a city to help Washington free up billions of dollars to ensure that we are providing need, the most basic human needs and the most basic human rights, respecting those rights for all, everyone. And creating a green economy that is a steward to our Mother Earth and a just society. Now, in 350 Seattle, and my fellow 350 Seattleites, feel free to make noise. We have a little saying we like called break free. Now, fixing our progressive tax system gives us so many opportunities to break free. So I want to invite everyone to participate in this campaign as to the extent of their passion, because we can break free from this mythology that we don't have the revenue in this state to actually meet our most urgent needs, to mitigate climate catastrophe, to educate our children, and the mythology that tells us that we must pin these issues against each other, that we don't have enough revenue to have a robust education program for our kids, and can actually act as stewards to our environment, have a robust environmental protection program. In Olympia, they're telling us that we have to choose. Meanwhile, a grotesque amount of wealth sits stagnant atop of glass towers. So let us break free also from the mythology that tells us that this wealth is a product of personal and individual ambition and talent, when we know that it rests upon a complex web of systemic interrelationships that involves everyone and comes at a cost of environmental degradation, climate catastrophe, and exploitation of the working class. And finally, let us free this wealth and use it to break free from fossil fuels and build a electrified grid of mass affordable transit and cooperative agriculture that runs on 100% renewable energy. And this can make sure that we are letting everyone move, feeding everyone and housing everyone, not just the wealthy, but every one of our brothers and sisters. And this is the story that we can tell with this campaign if we act now. So as a representative of the community, both District 4 and the climate community, I just want to invite Councilmember Johnson to work with us on this and tell this story. Thank you.
I think that's my cue. Thank you, sir.
So that was my cue. Thanks, everybody, for being here tonight. I just want to take a moment to just brag. You know, we in the District 4 are leading the way on so many different issues, and this is one great example. As the folks here tonight mentioned, they're planning on doing these town halls in all 7 city council districts. But which one is first? District 4. Which council member agreed to do that first? Rob Johnson. So, you know, I'm not big on speeches, especially at 8:45 on a Thursday night, but I just wanted to share a couple of quick things about why this is such an important issue to me. I'm a fifth generation Seattleite. I grew up here, my family's from here, my great-grandmother moved to Capitol Hill in the late 1800s. The city of Seattle has changed a lot over that last 130 years, and one of the biggest changes that we've seen is loss and degradation of our natural environment. We're seeing the impacts of climate change today more rapidly than any other time in recorded history. We live in a city that prides ourselves on environmental protection, but we're in an environment where the president's budget cuts all funding for cleanup of Puget Sound. We're living at a time where we're watching our native southern orca population be decimated by the loss of their natural Chinook salmon. And the response from the federal government is to take more money away from the protection of that endangered species. And so I'm a big believer that this is one of the best ways for us to stand up and say we will fight back against those environmental rollbacks coming from the Trump administration. And I think that this is a good time for us to do it. So another reason why I care about this campaign is because I've got 3 little girls. I've got 2 6-year-olds in kindergarten up at Bryan Elementary and a 3.5-year-old who's in a little preschool right behind the Green Lake Library. And when I was down in Olympia all day today lobbying legislators about fixing Washington's paramount duty and making investments in our education system, I want to echo what I heard from Michael, that we didn't hear a whole lot of opportunities for compromise. What I heard was, guess what, Seattle? You're going to pay more and you're probably going to get less. We're going to ask you to help raise up revenues for everybody else, but we're probably not going to give you any increase in revenue for the kids in your schools. And I'm fortunate enough that we go to a public school where the PTSA is very well off. We raise tens of, if not hundreds of thousands of dollars to help support our kids and our schools. But that inequity shouldn't be on the burden of those parents, and it should be shared amongst all of us as citizens. This campaign is a great opportunity for us to make sure that we show our kids our values and that we value them as top priority. This is a great opportunity for us to do that. I'm almost done. I just have the good politics speak in threes, Sarah, so we're on our third, and then I'll turn it over to you. So then the third reason why I care a lot about this issue is because we're living in a very insecure time for a whole lot of folks. Hate crimes in our city and our region are on the rise. I talk to immigrants and refugees every day that are scared to come to even our free events where we're talking to them about opportunities for them to be able to feel safe and stay in this community. I was talking with a representative of a nonprofit the other day that does a lot of immigrant rights trainings, and she said for the first time in 5 years, they held a training and no one showed up. And the reason why they believe no one showed up is because of the fear of coming to an official public meeting, and that being at that public meeting will result in someone knowing who you are, where you live, and telling Homeland Security and ICE that it's time for you to go home. That is not the city that I grew up in. That is not the city that I'm proud to represent, and we can do much better. The challenge that we have is the cuts that are coming from the federal government and the pressure from the federal government on us to really backfill those cuts. Katie talked about some of those in terms of our cuts to human services and our cuts to housing. Those are real cuts for us in a time where we are already seeing significant state and federal disinvestment in health and human services and housing. Mental health crisis is contributing to our homelessness. Job inequality is contributing to our homelessness. Income inequality is a huge issue for us to fix. And as Katie rightly mentioned, we're a city where if you look at us compared to all the other major cities in the United States, we have the fourth highest tax burden on the lowest income and the fourth best tax burden on the highest income. It is time for us to change that around to make our city a more equitable city for everybody. Now, there are some challenges. We as a council know that this potential income tax is going to be challenged through the courts. So we need to be deliberate. We need to be working hard to showcase that we've got a strong legal argument. Secondly, we need to work really hard to understand exactly what that income threshold is. There's a lot of good data and good policy that could point us in some different directions. That's still very much under discussion. And then the third issue is, with that laundry list of priorities we have as a city, how do we want to see those revenues invested in a way that is really consistent with our city's values and the values of our citizens? So those are some big to-dos that we have, but I really thank you all for being here today, and I want to encourage you to continue fighting, continue organizing, continue putting pressure on us, and with your support and with your work, we're going to get this thing done. Thank you very much.
Okay, can we give a big thank you to all the speakers? And now we have time for questions. Awesome. Right here, purple shirt. Everyone hear that question? So she's asking if the money raised from this proposed initiative will cover the full cut of money that we'll probably have cut from federal budgets.
So it's really hard to say because we don't know what pieces of Trump's proposed budget will end up actually going through. From what I've seen for at least the housing and human services, absolutely it would cover it. If we're talking about all the money for transit projects, probably not. Definitely not if we're talking about regional transit projects. But the other thing to keep in mind is just that when we talk about the what we're going to do with this money is that we're not going to get the revenue right away. So if there are immediate cuts that we think are going to happen, we can't count on this money for that because it's going to go through this legal process, and it wouldn't be until after the courts make a decision that we would get the revenue. So that does play into discussions about what this revenue should be dedicated to.
Black hat right here.
So you're referring to Initiative 1098, which was in 2010. So that was a statewide initiative, and it failed statewide. But if you look at the vote in Seattle and other sort of progressive cities around the state, it passed strongly. So Seattle voters voted for 1098 by 63%. So we believe that we can pass this in Seattle.
Right here. So she's wondering about the linguistics behind the words such as rich and how that affects people and how they decide to vote for themselves or maybe against their own needs or against the needs of their city because of the way that something has been written or the words that have been chosen in the legislation.
So, I think we're a broad coalition. We're a broad campaign. Everyone in the coalition has different thoughts on everything from revenue dedication to income threshold to messaging. There are definitely those in the coalition who are really about the tax the rich because we've seen that has a lot of momentum behind it in the grassroots community and the low income community. When I was preparing what I was going to say tonight, I kind of whether I said it or not, for me, it's important to seize this as a way of seeing everyone's paying their fair share, and what I would just advocate is that everyone in this room and everyone in this city is their own advocate. And if you have messaging that works personally for you, you write it down and call your council member, because what we're working to do with this model of organizing is also opening the dialogue and making our city officials and our constituents together feeling, our organizers, our activists, our politicians, being in a room together, being accessible, having these conversations. And if I would just suggest, if there's messaging that works for you, then when you take it to the streets, you use that. Yeah.
In the back blue shirt. So her questions was, one, what kind of talking points do we have to respond to people who give excuses about why this is not going to work? For example, people who are rich will just leave the city because then they don't have to pay it. And number two, so then Olympia will say Seattle is off the hook and they don't have to give as much state funding to us because we have a city income tax. So who wants to address those two questions?
On the second one, I would just say Olympia's not giving a shit right now. So, I don't know. We just have to push forward. On the first, I can promise that we will expand the FAQ on the TrumpProofSeattle.org website to address those questions. On the one about people moving out of Seattle or jobs or whatever, California has high income taxes, right? San Francisco has high income taxes, and they seem to be doing okay.
Could I just even add, if people are willing to spend their high incomes on the current rents, or they're willing to buy property in the city of Seattle, which is a huge, huge tax in one form or another, 1.5% is not going to make them leave, right? This is a very, very small change. It's going to do a lot of good, but they put up with much worse to live in the city, and we all think it's worth it for some reason.
And I would say, actually, I'm out here at the farmer's market every Saturday morning, either myself or one of my staff members. And one of the most common things that I hear from people is, what can we do to help? How can we do more? And that comes from people at all income levels. But I hear it more often than not from those that are very well-to-do. And so I think that we actually, because of what Katie said about that 63% of folks who voted yes in 2010, and by the way, the city's grown by about 100,000 people since then, we could very easily find a larger majority of folks that are willing to stand up with us for progressive sources.
Way in the back, blue shirt.
like most things that are citizen-driven, I think we're working really hard with the folks who are pulling together the concept to make sure that we all know exactly what our end game looks like. So a lot of this is about coordination between the 40 organizations that have signed on to the campaign and making sure that we're all in lockstep about what a set of legal strategies and other political strategies would look like to make sure we're successful. And then the second thing is, I commit to, as a member of the budget committee, making this a priority for us over the next year to make sure that we're really driving a political conversation that helps us get to yes at a council. Now, will that happen this year? Maybe, maybe not. If it doesn't happen this year, I can tell you that by this point next year, we'll have a plan well-booked, well-baked and ready to go. Sorry, it's been a long day. Well-baked and ready to go so that in 2018, you'll see something come forward from us for sure.
In the back with the glasses. So this woman had a great comment about how this proposal is different than the previous proposal because this is a remedial, this is a solution to a problem that we're seeing from the federal level. So therefore, it might not be seen as unconstitutional differently than the previous tax proposal that was statewide. So I actually only have time for two more. Do you want to respond to that? Anyway? No? Daniel?
Yeah, just a quick question for the council member. Can you let us know why we can't do that this year and why it has to be next year?
You know, I think that this has a lot to do with legal timelines, right? How do we really make sure that we're working with the legal community to develop a sound legal strategy? And sometimes that takes time. In addition to that, we want to make sure that we're doing a good job of working with coalition partners and bringing people along. That takes time. The political organizing that you guys are doing takes time. You know, I think that there's a sound way for all of that, all those Venn diagrams to come together that gives us a pathway forward in 2017. But I'm less confident of guaranteeing what that looks like, especially knowing that there are lawyers involved. This stuff just is something that takes time, and we want to make sure that we get it right. And I would rather wait a little while and get it right and know that we've got a sound legal strategy than move quickly and know that we're going to get it wrong and set the movement backwards. You know, again, I'm relying on the work that the coalition is doing right now to build a lot of political movement and a lot of political power. I know that there are folks within the legal community that are doing the research. I haven't been approached by those lawyers yet, which makes me think that they're not quite ready to come in and make an argument to us yet.
Okay, we have time for just one. Kevin, you want to add one more comment?
And just to respectfully respond to that, right? For one, I think that us organizers can work to set up a meeting with the law firms that we've been working with. And two, if anyone in this room is interested in, you know, helping our council member out by building that organizing in a quicker timeline, we will be actually organizing weekly delegation visits to his open office hours for like at the farmers market or on Friday mornings to check in and see how we can make this happen this year.
So we have time for just one more question right here in the plaid.
I sort of wanted to make a comment, a public comment.
Yeah, go for it.
So I just want to say thanks again for being part of this, Councilmember Johnson. It's great to have you on the City Council. I don't think we've seen each other since working together on Sound Transit 2 back in 2008. You played a huge role in winning that campaign, and I'm a big fan of yours. And now I'm hoping you can play a big role in winning this next big campaign.
This is not a setup.
In the 9 years since Sound Transit 2, I've been trying to get a wealth tax in Washington. I'm still an engineer at one of our large software companies, so I'm fortunate enough that I qualify for this wealth tax, and I can't wait to pay it. Because because I want to do my fair share to keep Seattle wonderful. My Seattle roots stretch back to my grandfather. To get to New York, he actually came through the Seattle Immigration Office. In fact, that's where I got the last name of Friend. That name was a mistake, but a welcoming one. My grandfather came here to escape the pogroms and build a better life, and he did. He sent my dad to a good public school, who went on to become a medical school professor at Harvard. I'd like to think my grandfather would have the same good fortune if he arrived today, because I love Seattle and our progressive values, but we aren't living up to those values, as we've talked about tonight. We aren't really welcoming new immigrants. Our public schools, as you mentioned, are criminally underfunded. Rent is skyrocketing. Tents line our highways. It hit home for me a few weeks ago. I was driving south on I-5 with my family, and we were all just listening to music. And out of nowhere, my 7-year-old daughter says to me, I want to get all those people presents. I look around and I'm like, what people? And she says, all those people living in tents. I want to get people out of those tents. I want to fully fund my daughter's public school. I want to make to get to work by bus and train. And I want to support immigrants like my grandparents. So in short, I want Seattle to invest more in our public services, $100 million more. The kind of money we can only raise through taxes. But I don't want the poor to pay. I want to personally support our city with my wealthy peers, and many of them agree with me. So let's keep Seattle wonderful with a wealth tax. I know you can make it happen. Thank you, Rob.
Thank you to everyone, all our speakers, and thank you to all the wonderful questions. I'm sorry we don't have time for more. We have one more thing before we break. Two things, apparently, that has just been known to me.
I have a 71 to catch.
Yeah, can we give a big thank you to Rob, Councilman Member Rob Johnson? Okay. Two things that we're going to be doing now. I think you're coming up next. I was not aware of that, but here's the mic.
Hi. My name's Scott Myers, and I'm the lead organizer from the Transit Riders Union. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the stuff we've been doing. Thank you. So when we started the Transit Riders Union, we dedicated ourselves to the idea that public policy should serve the interests of the whole society, not just the profits of the few. We also had this crazy idea that the people who are most affected by public policy, such as transit policy, for instance, should have a say in how that policy works. And at the time, they were threatening to cut our bus service by about 17%. And before we even had a Transit Riders Union, we just went on the bus and talked to people, and we found out most people didn't even know this was happening. And so this is what gave us the idea to start organizing around this. We founded an organization of poor and working people, including students, seniors, people with disabilities, just people that are often thrown under the bus as often as they're offered a seat on it, and are kind of treated as disposable by our society, even though if they're not already the majority, they are fast becoming the majority in these times. When we started, I never imagined just how difficult it would be to build an organization. And the biggest thing I ran into that really surprised me, and I guess it probably wouldn't surprise you if you're older than me, is apathy. There's so much, like you go out and people are just, they seem sort of beaten down, demoralized. And not just like the poorest people, like most of us are kind of, you know, walking around almost like zombies, and it's sort of beaten into us that you can't change the world. It's not your world, it's their world, and you're just passing through it. And yeah, well, that's what I thought too, and I still, you know, just as soon as they sort of drill that into you and sort of kill that spark that you have, Then they come in, the advertisers come in with, drugs and drink and parties and just like all sorts of things that just kind of, you know, they're fun, but they still don't quite reach you where you need, you know, they reach that that place inside you. We become slaves to those things. The Transit Riders Union, despite these things that we faced, we kept going and we organized. And despite our lack of experience, we learned by doing. We fought and we won some things. I mean, we staved off bus cuts. Even though we were offered like a regressive tax, a car tab fee, which we didn't like. Of course, we weren't that sophisticated back then. We didn't know the difference. We just didn't want them to cut our buses. And that's one of the ways that they divide our movement is, you know, they put the poor people against the middle class people and, you know, people with, last fall, we were working on a campaign to win more bus tickets for social service agencies. When I was working on that campaign, it was a very important campaign. It was a much smaller thing though than what we're doing here. And I never in a million years thought I would be doing this year, because this is just a way bigger thing. But November came. And it brought November rain. any Guns N' Roses fans? Anyway, it brought a cold, dark, dark winter. We did not retreat. We did not curl up and hibernate. We got busy, and we reached out to our friends and our allies, and together we put together a coalition. And we've been out on the streets organizing in the rain and the cold, and we built upon the foundation of our 5 years of experience something new, and something that we're discovering and working out new ways of working together and of building power and exercising power together. And you know what? Spring is in the air. So organizing is not glamorous work, but it's work for sure. And when you do it enough, something happens. You go out and you're gathering signatures and you're talking to people, you're reaching out, and you start to realize you're not alone. A lot of people think the way that you do. You kind of realize the world isn't such a nasty place. Like all these people that when you have your earbuds in, you feel like they're like out to get you or intrude upon you or something like that. They're actually like your friends. They're your brothers and sisters. And you start to realize that. The more you talk to people, the more confident you get. I've seen it happen with many people, you know, who just don't, you know, never talk to strangers. And then you can go into a room and you're not scared. You're just like, oh, I could handle all these people. You know, I've talked to like a million people. You start to feel not just the cheap thrills that come from all of the consumer comforts, but the joy that comes from being part of the world and being active in the world and changing the world and from making it your world and our world and taking it back. That's what we're figuring out, how to take this world back from the politicians and the corporations and all the people that run it, you know, for the sake of the profit of minorities. Springtime in Seattle, a new power is rising, or at least is budding. I don't know if I say it's rising, but well, every week we need these buds to keep growing until our dark November is just a dark memory, and it will be overgrown by the brilliant foliage of our movement. And we're going to win. We're going to win. But that's not going to happen if we stay inside and if we retire to private life. It's only going to happen if we reach out and if each and every one of us does everything we can to kindle the flames of democracy. And I'm going to tell you just two ways you can do that. First one is the easy one. You can just you can join the Transit Riders Union, or you know, one of any of the organizations in our coalition. Why is this so important? Well, imagine a meeting like this, but at the end we put the question to a vote, and that vote becomes law. That's how a Transit Riders Union meeting works. There's a gavel. That's when it becomes law, when the gavel comes down. imagine us like city council meetings that work that way. Imagine our government working that way. Well, that's what democracy is supposed to be. That's the promise of democracy. And that promise is only going to be fulfilled if we make it happen. And so imagine also if it's not just transit, but housing, healthcare, workplace issues, like in every neighborhood there's a, you know, and that's our coalition. We've got the NACs in every neighborhood. We've got the environment. We've got all sorts of people on this coalition. So you can, by joining the Transit Riders Union or any of these organizations, you're nurturing them. And you're, these are the buds that are trying desperately to open. And these are the seeds that are germinating and starting to sprout. So it's very important. And this is what, this will keep these organizations accountable to you and not to, you know, big foundations and corporate donations and things like that. And so that's really important. And the second thing you can do is more important than just joining. It's like, we need you to get active. We need you to participate. We have these petition cards, and you can fill these out, but you can help us gather petition cards. We're going to pack City Hall. As Kevin said, we're going to bring people out to other town halls. We're going to bring them out to office hours. We're just going to we're not going to go away. We need this to be bigger every single week than it was the past week, and that's what's going to make it happen this year and not next year. I'll just give you an idea of a few things coming up. We got a full schedule, but this weekend, you know, on Saturday, 10 to 2, we'll be out at the farmers market gathering signatures. So I don't even know which direction I'm facing. Just right out here. On Sunday, we're going to have a work party from at Casa Latina from 1 to 5. And we'll be making signs, we'll be doing data entry, all sorts of stuff to make this campaign going. On Monday, Kevin's going to be out leading at Whole Foods in Ravenna. So those from 10 to 2, right? So come out to one of those things, help us gather signatures. So once again, spring is upon us, and it's up to you to determine whether or not summer will bring the sweet fruit of victory. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Before everyone rushes out, one quick thing. In the envelope that was on your seat, there was that petition card. Please fill the petition card out. Secondarily, there's another card in there. It's a donation card. We are all basically volunteers, which means that we don't have a lot of money to make this campaign happen. And if you want to make sure that this tax initiative passes, we need a little bit of support from as many people who can give as much support as possible. None of this would be possible without renting this space or buying a computer or printing anything. And we have 6 more town halls to go. Thank you, Danny, for reminding me. Exactly, which means we need a little bit of help from everyone in this room. So no matter how much you can give, everything is welcome and everything is going to be helpful. Even a dollar or two is going to make that much more of a difference to help us have as many successful town halls as possible so that we can make sure that our city council votes the right way on this tax initiative and really takes back the city from...
The more we raise tonight, the more Rob Johnson knows we are serious about.
Yeah, seriously. He will know, the city council will know if we raise money for him, if we raise money for this tax initiative. So please fill out everything in that envelope. And then outside, we have a table with buckets to collect those envelopes with your petition cards. There's a bucket right here with this lovely lady for your donations and your cards. And we also have people outside to answer any more questions that you may have and didn't get a chance to ask. And then last, we have a really cool really quick social media campaign outside. We have whiteboards for you to write down why you support the tax initiative, and we're going to take those photos and post them to social media. Tag Rob Johnson, tag our city council, so that they know for as long as possible, and that we're flooding that media, flooding their pages, flooding the internet about how much we care about this tax initiative. So thank you so much, everyone, for coming. Thank you for sitting for this long. Please enjoy the rest of the activities outside.